Welcome to the 2020-2021 Test Stand Automation and Regulation, or TSAR, ECE Capstone Handoff. That was a lot of words. We have Josh, Seth, and Jennifer, and they are the folks who did this capstone. We're missing Kate. Is she going to join us?
I don't think so.
Okay. All right. Let's start with an overview of the system and block diagrams and what it does and let people ask questions and all that kind of stuff. And then we'll start diving into specifics.
Okay. Let me pull up the block diagram real quick. Is it cool if I just show it in draw.io?
Yeah, perfect. Okay. And if people want to follow along, where is all of this documentation?
This diagram is in the PSAS shared drive in the SAR folder.
Good.
I think it's subfolder design or something.
And is this inside LFETS, or is this SAR have its own folder?
SAR has its own folder inside LFETS.
Inside LFETS, okay, good.
Sorry, I need to delete a bunch of extra diagrams I have around, but this is the main one.
Okay.
All right.
So, yeah, one thing we need is a smaller block diagram, like almost like more like a level zero block diagram.
We might have one in here somewhere.
It's okay. We can just step through this one.
Oh, there we go. There it is.
That's very level zero. All right. Go ahead and explain all the things.
Okay. Going off of this very basic diagram, we have a laptop which is viewing all of the data, and it's also sending out controls to this Linux server. These are separate because the Linux server and the laptop are 300 feet away from each other. I'll have Josh and Seth go in more detail on like how everything that works, but you're just SSHing into a Linux server. You have a data acquisition system collecting a bunch of data, and you have these valves which are being controlled. The very detailed one. So again, here is the laptop. There is also like a power and data system and a little bit of a safety system here. So we have all of the power and data going into a Lotto box, which is just a physical box that houses all of the hardware on.
Which stands for?
Huh?
Which stands for?
Oh, lockout tagout box. We have a bunch of pictures in our report that we'll pull up later, but it has like 9 key switches. And the idea is that if anyone is past the safety line and going up to the test stand, they have to carry a key with them. And this prevents the test stand from being powered up. And then when you get back, you put the key back in the box and here you go. It also has an emergency stop button and a power switch. This is because we have a main battery on the, I guess we'll just call it command side, which is like behind the safety line. This battery supplies power over Ethernet, and it supplies power to all of the data acquisition and the main controller. And that power is going over this PoE plus. There is a secondary PoE line, which is going to power the valves only. And this was a design decision so that if we needed to cut power to the test stand, we could cut power to just the valves and still receive data, which is really important to know what is going on, so we're not just walking up to the test stand blind if something does go wrong.
I think so. Are you monitoring your power and your battery at any point?
Sorry, what was that?
Are you monitoring your power voltage at any time? So if the battery, in other words, sometimes you start to set up a test, things get delayed for hours, and after a while, your battery may go down and you may not even know it.
We do not. That was a thought that we had at some point, but I think that's something that the next team should absolutely do is battery monitoring.
Well, hold on. Where are those new 12-volt lithium ion batteries?
They're
at the test stand. Okay.
Yeah, we have the main battery here, which we can absolutely do a test on. And then we have 24-volt test stand battery, which is just supplying the valves. Mm-hmm. So we have this secondary PoE. It's just going to a solenoid relay. So it prevents the power from these batteries to go to the actuator controller, or it enables it. So these two batteries, which are at the test stand, only supply power to the valves and the igniter.
Those 24 volt batteries, we can monitor the voltage on, by the way, over Bluetooth. So
right, that's what I was gonna say. That those hilarious batteries with the built-in Bluetooth.
I totally forgot about that.
Things, yeah. We should maybe buy another one actually for the 12 volt on the test stand. That's just so great. Do we have a battery for the it's called test stand? Sorry, for launch control for the controller.
We did, but it was broken.
The battery?
Yeah.
Okay. So it doesn't work?
Not that I know of. Okay. There, we were poking it and someone accidentally shorted some of the lines, so it got fried.
Oh, wow. Okay. Some of the lines. No, do we actually have a battery? So right there it says main battery with something inverter. Do we have an actual battery that works?
Not right now, no.
Okay, all right.
We're just plugging everything into the wall.
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay. All right, so we'll need a battery.
We do have like hardware power indicator. We have a 3-LED tower light. One of the green is hooked up to the PoE plus on the test stand side. So that should light up whenever that power is active. We have an orange LED attached to the PoE at the test stand side, and then a red on the other side of the relay. So if the test stand battery is supplying power past that relay. Yeah, that's just a visual indication, just an extra thing we had. So I already talked about the power there. So the 24 volts is going into the actuator controller. We have that MOSFET network so that it's all triggered by software.
Hold on, let's talk about tagging each of these boxes with an actual sort of key, like a color code or something, because they're all sort of the same level, so it's hard to tell what's important or not. So the actuator controller is a circuit board that is a safety critical system that actually triggers the valves, right?
Yes.
So maybe like fill that one in with red or purple or something. All right, there you go. And then the key switch, can you zoom in a little bit more? It's hard to read those. The key switch relay box, is that a circuit board? Are any of those circuit boards before that actuator controller?
We have the logic board, which is just basically an AND gate network. Mm-hmm. And we have this Lotto keyboard, which I can show the boards later, but it just has like LED indication that's like isolated power from the actual PoE.
Okay.
So just those two boards.
Okay. All right, keep going. Sorry, thanks.
Oh, you're good. So coming back up here, just to understand the data flow a little better. So we have the main PoE plus power going over and supplying power to the main processor, the data acquisition, and the other boards here. So it goes into this PoE input board. It just has one regulator, and it also just splits off power cabling to the various boards in on the test stand. And physically, it also mounts the central manager, our main processor, the BeagleBone AI. And that this board is just commercial off the shelf. It's what hosts our Linux server. Again, Josh and Seth can go into more detail on the software and firmware side.
I'm going to keep asking clarifying questions.
Yeah, go for it.
So the PoE Plus board makes gives out 24 volts. On that board, you've got a 24 to 5 volt a converter. And that runs the BeagleBone AI and all the sensors and all the part of the data acquisition system, right?
Not just this one regulator, but yeah, the power itself splits off because we had another 5-volt regulator on one of our boards. So we just eliminated that and then just simplified it down so we didn't have like redundant regulators.
That makes sense. Where does the 24 volts from that go anywhere else?
Yes.
I see a line going to the right. Where does that go?
Yeah, so we have one 24 volt line going into the sensor front end board, and we have the 5-volt regulated line also going in there.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have this 24 volts going into our valve indicator board.
Ah, okay, okay.
Yeah,
and so, then another
5-volt line going in.
You have the green, orange, red tower, right? LED tower.
Yes, we have two LED towers. We have a 3 LED one and a 4 LED one.
Ah, okay. So what's the name difference between the two?
I was calling the 3 LED one the power indicator tower because all it does is show the power domains.
Yep.
And then the valve indicator tower for the 4 LED tower.
Awesome. Okay, thanks. I didn't realize you had two towers.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we needed another LED for the data on this one. So
okay.
Let's see. Right. So main processor, that's what collects all of the data from the DAC and sends out controls to the actuator controller. See, again, actuator controller gets commands from the AI. It also has its own internal automated software, which definitely have Seth and Josh go in more detail. And that just sends out those commands to the valves and the igniter. This AC board is also connected to the valve indicator tower. Let me come back to that because it'll make more sense going through the data system. So the BeagleBone AI is connected to this Marionette, which was a PSAS project. It's open source DAC hardware. And that is collecting all of the data from this sensor front end board. Let's see. So the sensor front end board is basically just an intermediate board. It takes all of these different data, all of this different sensor data and just like conditions it out. And some of it goes through analog to digital converters on this board, sends off to the Marionette. The Marionette also has its own analog to digital converters. So we're just kind of balancing the available lines on that. I think there's like 44 sensors total coming into this board. Sorry. we're also getting 4 sensors from this thrust plate amplifier board. This was last year's capstone. We have not changed it at all. So if you watch the other handoff, they go into more detail. I'm not going to talk about it today because we literally did not change anything about it. Okay, so distracting. The other type of sensors that come into this board are the valve position sensors. And instead of hooking them up directly, since they're going into this other board, we just have it connected through another wire harness from our valve indicator board.
They're actually in parallel, Andrew. So we're reading the sensors in two different locations.
I didn't understand. I didn't understand that, Seth. What do you mean in parallel?
The Hall effect sensors are being read on the valve indicator tower's STM32 and also on the ADC on the sensor front end that goes into the marionette.
Oh, that's what you mean by parallel. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So this, we have another SEM processor on this board. So all that this is doing is collecting the valve position sensors. It's also getting the current state of the valves from the actuator controller. And it's just comparing those two. So if anything mismatches, like if it's supposed to be in a specific state and it's not, it will throw up an error code over that for LED tower.
What colors could the LED tower be?
Red, orange, green, and blue.
For each of the four rings?
No, just they're single color.
Okay, all right.
So I have a question. Are you recording all this stuff live, I assume, someplace? I mean, not this meeting, but I mean, once you actuate and start doing something, are you recording all the data? Because if you have a failure, it'd be very good to know exactly what happened before the failure occurred.
Yeah, the valve indicator tower has an SD card on it. So we're storing an error log there. And I think that we're storing a different set of events on the laptop side for the GUI, from the GUI.
What do you mean by difference of events? Are you recording all events or only events that are abnormal?
Josh, what are we storing on the laptop side?
On the GUI side, we record all the communications, so all commands, like data packets that are being parsed and handled. And on the VI side, we recording like the different states and stuff.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So these are very, what I would call, cross-linked systems, which is fine. Sometimes a real system is like that, so that's fine.
Yeah, when we get to suggestions, one of the suggestions I'll be making is to eliminate one of the systems.
Uh-oh, eliminating systems. That sounds like simplification stuff. That's weird.
Yeah, okay. Well, I think it'll make it better.
Okay, let's move on. Okay, so the actuator controller goes to the valves and igniter, and then you've got the valve indicator tower. And the valve indicator tower actually has its own circuit board, right?
Yes.
And it's looking at the sensor front end board is where the valve position indicators come in.
So the valve position sensors, those Hall effect sensors, are going to the valve indicator tower, and like we're reading it on the STM32 on the valve indicator tower, and then the same signal is being sent to the sensor front end board and getting read on the ADC, the off chip ADC on the sensor front end board.
Yeah. Okay.
But the raw signal, right? Not after it's been read by the ADC, because we're interpreting it basically digitally. We only care if it's open or closed.
Okay, that's perfectly fine.
So the buff indicator is also communicating with the actuator controller, and it's basically getting every single state. Every single time we change the state, it gets the state, and so it compares with the actual value of the bulbs.
Oh, so you have another serial port coming off the actuator controller that's going to the valve indicator tower.
Yeah, just for safety precautions.
Can you guys feature creep yourselves? Okay, I didn't know about this. All right, so that's how it does the comparison. I was wondering about that. Okay, so actuator controller UARTs the data over to the valve indicator tower. Valve indicator tower is also looking and yells at us if it's not the same. So we expect it to yell at us for a few seconds, right? When the actuator controller says, I'm changing this valve, and the valve indicator tower, there's a several seconds what it takes to change the valve. I would expect to see something wrong for several seconds.
I think we've got like a grace period, right? But we only got to actually moving the valves last Sunday. So I'm sure the grace period is wrong.
Okay.
Yeah, so the main benefit of keeping that processor there is if for some reason we lose data over our power over Ethernet, we still have a visual indication of what's going on at the test stand. That's really the main benefit of having it. Yeah, that's pretty much it for like the overview of the system. Do we want to go into software or hardware, or what do we want to look at first?
Let's go over the GitHub repo for where all the hardware is that we just went over.
All right, PSAS, SAR hardware.
Okay.
So this obviously needs to be updated, but we do have like a little basic input of like where, which boards are in this repo and what they are called.
Oh, that's perfect. Good.
I also included links to different code if those boards have specific codes. So first one, we have the lockout tagout. We have our logic board and the keyboard and a little brief overview of how those are hooked up. PoE plus input is that first, this power splitter board right here. And it's a little block diagram there.
You know what would be kind of cute and helpful? Is to go back to the block diagram, and every time something's a board, make it a thick purple outline of the box, like Osh Park purple, right? And that way we know that that particular box is actually a circuit board.
Yeah, you can
do that. Sorry, so keep going.
Yeah, you're good. Thrust play amplifier. Again, there's that. This was all Mike Hall. I think he was the one who designed that. I just updated the block diagrams. Actuator controller. Again, there's that. SAR sensor front end board. Again, that intermediate board. So, thrust plate, sensor front end.
All right, so this one repo has all the circuit boards and layouts and schematics and everything, plus an overview. That's great. Okay.
Yeah, and I also made sure to include any libraries that are added in that aren't in the Eagle standard. So they are all in there too.
And where are they? Sorry, I didn't see where you said libraries. Great. Okay, is there anything else we should talk about? What's the board outline folder?
That was just so that I could make all of the boards the same shape and size, and it was basing it off the Marionette because that's the largest board that we have, just so we could stack them all.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then the BeagleBone, just because we were mounting that, and the Nucleo on the EC.
Great. Okay. Next, let's do, I think software.
All right, Josh or Seth, do you want to share your screens?
You want to go ahead, Josh? I'll have to hop on my laptop for mine.
Hold on before you start. Jennifer, so what you just showed us, the block diagram, there is also a wiring diagram, or there, what's the right way to say this? There is a physical system that's now hooked up on the test stand. Do we have a wiring diagram somewhere?
That, cabling, Andrew, is a term.
Yeah, thanks. A cabling diagram that goes that, that for that current system?
I did include labels on our system block diagram, just showing like power cable and stuff, but yeah. That's pretty much all we have right now.
Okay, that's fine. The cable diagrams never survive the real world. So it's okay. As long as you've labeled the actual cables about what they are on this, on the physical test stand, we can figure it out from the block diagram.
Yeah. And I tried to label the boards, just on the silk screen, like where they're going and what they're connected to. So definitely have to go through that once we get to the hardware sections.
Okay. Seth, before, or Josh, before you guys start, can you talk about all the different software projects on the system, like just a quick overview?
Sure. Go ahead, Seth.
Oh, yeah. So there's software on the BeagleBone, which handles communicating with the marionette and the actuator controller, basically. There's the software on the laptop side, which basically just a GUI and handles the data coming back and opens the SSH with the Linux. The actuator controller contains the state machine largely, which controls the actual valves and responds to the commands from the BeagleBone. It also gets data from the valve indicator regarding the physical state of the valves, and it can use that data to stop, basically. Then there's the marionette's firmware, which handles sensor input and sends that data to the Linux on BeagleBone AI. And I think that's all of the main software.
Did you just say the valve indicator?
Oh, sorry. And then there's the valve indicator. The valve indicator is also basically a state machine. That's not true. I think she did have to put a operating system on it to use the SD card. So that is a file system.
Okay.
Yeah. The marionette runs on ChibiOS. The actuator controller has no operating system. BeagleBone is Linux, obviously.
And the valve indicator?
Valve indicator, I believe she used ChibiOS. I'd have to double check.
Okay.
Okay, so the BeagleBone AI. So the BeagleBone AI is basically our main hub, and the marionette and actual controller boards connect to the BeagleBone AI using serial over USB. So to make the communication between the marionette and the actual controller and BeagleBone AI possible, we created a Python script named as multibb.py, which we can find at the GitHub repo on the software side. So the main point of the Python script is to provide safe handling of data and communications and to achieve the parallelism needed to process all the marionette data and user commands, we implemented a FIFO queue. But because the marionette connects, uses a serial connection on its own, and we also need to communicate with the actuator controller in another serial connection, we use in the multi-processing package, and we'll share the data packets that come in from the marionette and the user commands through a FIFO queue before we send them to the actuator controller. That way, basically the data it's not missed, or like everything's organized. So the data packets are composed of a validation key, just to verify it's a valid data packet. We got 2D sensor values on it, and within those 2D sensors, we have all the valves positioning. So jumping into the actuator controller, So the actuator controller integrates the ST-Link debugger programmer, which helps us with flashing the board with any extra hardware. It has 11 states total and five.
Hold on, sorry. Let's go a little bit more into depth. So all of this is written, I don't think you said Python. This is all Python, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And is it one Python? I assume it's multiple Python files, and there's three different processes that are being launched when you boot the BeagleBone, right?
No, that is one Python file, and it basically what it does is creates three processes. One process is going to handle the actuator controller process, which will communicate with the marionette for all the commands and stuff.
Wait. You just said two different things. The actuator process, I assume, does not talk to the marionette, or it does?
Well, so we have three processes, right?
Yeah.
And one process will communicate with the marionette and get all the data packets.
Right.
Those data packets are going to be stored in a FIFO queue that will connect with the AC process.
Gotcha. Okay. So you have a queue or FIFO from the marionette process that's just grabbed all the data, and that FIFO goes into the AC process, so it gets the data and can send it to the AC.
Right.
Is there another queue to get back to the laptop?
The laptop is basically using Paramico, and it's just like an SSH implementation.
Okay.
So everything that this script says, like Paramico will pick up and will parse the data and show it on the GUI.
Okay.
So the FIFO queue idea was so that when we get like the user commands in data packets, so that we have like safe data and kind of like in an organized way to send it to the actuator controller.
Sure.
We also have another process which is very important, and it's a writer process. And what this process do is just print out every single thing the actuator controller says. That way, if we have like warning, error messages, like anything, we must print it out. And those are the three main processes within the one Python script for the BeagleBone AI.
Okay, and that's the only thing running on the BeagleBone, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm sorry, I don't understand one thing, so I'm gonna keep asking obnoxious questions. So I'm on the laptop, right? And I type SSH space, whatever the BeagleBone AI's address is. And then I log in with hopefully a password and a login. I don't know what that is, but default or whatever, right? And now I'm SSH'd in. How, I have a GUI I wanna run. How do I connect my laptop GUI to the BeagleBone?
So as soon as you connect the Ethernet cable to your laptop and you run the GUI script, which is also like done in Python, it will go through like all the connection and other connection by itself. So it would just like connect to the BeagleBone AI, run the script that is on the BeagleBone AI, and it will start parsing data.
Okay, so you run the script on your laptop, it runs into the BeagleBone, starts the script on the BeagleBone, and then it somehow extracts the marionette data. You used a funny word, which I think was a Python library called something with a P.
Multi-processing?
Paramico. Paramico is the library for the GUI.
Right.
Okay, so how does it extract the data from this script?
Right, so Paramico is basically a client-server SSH, uses the SSH protocol. So Paramico will basically grab anything that is on a standard out. So as the script in the BeagleBone prints anything, Paramico will grab it and then parse the data automatically.
That's cute, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So there's a standard out pipe that goes into the P Paramico thing, which I don't have. How do you spell that?
P Pramiko.
Okay.
Pramiko.
It's a weird name. Okay, so it grabs it from standard out and then grabs it. Okay, that's perfectly fine. That in this diagram, it would be nice to have another arrow that says Pramiko over here and standard out as a labeled arrow, so that we know that there's a, because there really is another output from this script.
Cool. Do you have any other questions regarding the script on the BeagleOne AI?
The writer process to the terminal screen, is that being saved somewhere?
I set it up on the GUI side to just log all that communication. So yes.
Okay, so it's just being logged to a text file.
Right.
Okay. So I'm the only one asking questions, technical questions. All the other people should ask technical questions too, just for the record. Okay, keep going.
Actually, I have one question. All your libraries that you're using, are you saving them here? Or do we have to pull them in from elsewhere? Because sometimes libraries change over time. And if we're not saved the version, we could get screwed up here.
I see. That's a good, yeah. You will have to install, for the BeagleOne AI script, you will have to install, or I don't know if multiprocessing comes already, ready to use. But for the GUI side, you will have to install Pramiko for sure.
It's okay. The only thing. Do you have documentation about what libraries you need and how to install this on the BeagleBone?
Yes, we...
Awesome.
Yep.
And the version? Sometimes you're version dependent.
Right, yeah, right.
That installation should have the version number in it so that we know which one you guys used. So if you need to add that, please do.
Yes, I definitely need to.
Okay, cool, thanks. Because Ed's right, we'll start this up next year, and you know we'll do an apt-get upgrade on the BeagleBone or something, and it'll screw everything up, and it will be tearing our non-existent hair out. Okay.
Okay, so moving into the actuator controller.
Actually, sorry, can you pull up the repo that has the BeagleBone software for a second?
Yeah. I have to share different window.
You might have to stop sharing, yeah, and then share a different screen.
Okay, so this is the repo for PizzaStar software. Mm-hmm. And all the actuator controller revisions are here. This is the latest one.
Well, hold on. We'll get to the actuator controller in a second. Go to the BeagleBone first.
Oh, my bad. That's right. So this is the latest one.
Okay. Great. So it's literally just a Python script. Okay.
Right.
And are the dependencies of the script listed somewhere?
I have to update the which packages you need to install and the versions and all that stuff, but.
Okay.
Okay. So moving to the actuator controller, this is the FSM diagram that is running on the actuator controller. So basically, we're using a Nucleo board, and it integrates the ST-Link debugger programmer, which helps us with flashing the board without any extra hardware. And we basically have 11 states total, and 5 states are part of the ignition automatic sequence that starts at ignition and ends on safety. Every single time we turn on the actual controller, we always start at safety, And we wanted a valve check state where we can turn an individual valve on or off. We actually have a cycle valve command that goes through each individual valve, like turning on and off each by like 1.5 seconds. We have a command that turns all the valves off. So if you wanna check, like if you wanna turn different valves on and you just wanna turn them all off, you just type that specific command. And we can see like the different transitions that we can do, like lux prefill, lux spill. And if anything goes wrong, and this is the section that we haven't finished yet, because we need the data from the LFETs, we need to know what is the nominal range values for the shutdown state, the transition to a shutdown state. We also need the timing that will change on each state. And at that specific point, then if as we get the data packet and we parse it, we'll compare the sensor values against a nominal range. If that nominal range, depending on each state, is out of the range for any specific amount of time, then we'll proceed to shut down. That's the way that basically works. So commented data packets that come from the BeagleBone and AI are received using the Hall driver's interrupt sequence in the actuator controller. The user commands are compared through a switch statement, and data packets are processed to ensure a valid data packet and added to a FIFO queue. Within each state, we then grab a data packet from that FIFO queue and we process it just to make sure we have all the sensors correctly. The shutdown state is composed of basically turning all the valves off, doing a 2-second purge, and going back to safety, which safety is basically turning all the valves off.
So, excuse me, you said that you do a test to be sure you have all the sensors. I'm not so sure what you mean by that. Are you doing a self-test to be sure all the sensors are there, or what does that mean?
Basically, as we get the data packet from the BeagleBone AI, this data is being gathered at the sensor front end and sent to the MirrorNet, and the MirrorNet will create a data packet with all the sensor values that it sampled at that specific moment. And then once the data packet gets to the actuator controller, we'll parse that data and basically compare the sensor values against a nominal range, a valid nominal range.
Okay, so, good. So if a sensor is defective, you would then know it.
Right. And
okay, very good. Very good right. Self-test, yeah.
And sometimes like they want, it doesn't really matter at certain states if like it goes out of the range for like some time, but we're still under completion for that part.
And we wouldn't necessarily know if the sensor itself is bad, but we would know if the reading is like way wrong, and that would just indicate that there's a problem. We don't care why there's a problem as long
right,
as
that makes know. Sense. Yeah, but you have some kind. I mean, this is very good to do a self test on the system to be sure things seem nominal before you proceed.
We're doing only kind of basic corruption check because the communication protocols available to us are like honestly not great. But if any packet got like seriously mangled, like if the key's wrong, we just discard it, and we're getting samples often enough that we don't care about getting like a replacement. We'll just wait for the next one. And we're also using averaged values for the most part rather than the individual values, like a rolling average. If any individual packet has one of the sensors gets a little bit mangled in transmission, it'll get averaged out for the most part. And like with the amount of resolution that we can have on the sensors anyways, it was kind of hard to ensure that each individual packet was 100% correct. And even if we did ensure that, I'm not sure that that would make the system any more safe. So we decided to be okay with it.
What's your sampling rate then?
It's about 10 samples a second.
Yeah, that should be sufficient, I would think. Thank you.
It's a little bit better. We wanted 16 samples a second, but we're running it through two different operating systems and it slowed it down.
Yeah.
I do have a quick note on these different states. Can I share my screen real fast?
Yeah.
So in the LFAT SAR 2021 capstone, there is this state reference, which was filled out by LFETs.
I think we're gonna need to update this, by the way. When we did the test run with LFETs on Sunday, it seemed like some of the states had changed again.
Okay. Luckily, the code is pretty modular to make up for those changes. But we have all the valves, and then for each state that was in that block diagram, we have like the LOX fill, LOX chill, just shows like what state these controlled valves need to be in and what the hand valves should be in. And that just goes through from there. It's a good reference for future teams, and it will change. So
that's great. Can you go back and show us where that is again?
It's in the shared drive LFETs folder, okay. SAR 2021.
So you guys have data, Jennifer, will you share that folder again? Sorry. Okay, yeah. So your bill of materials is there, and go back to the folder. Sorry, I'm taking a quick tour. Okay, so you got a bunch of stuff in your capstone folder as opposed to the SAR folder. Okay, that's fine. We'll come back to that. Thanks.
By the way, I think that's good that's modular, because I had a question coming up later on, because I assume as we go forward, we're going to be changing valves the next, in the next year or so as we move different engines. And so it sounds like it's pretty easy to update the data that we're looking for in the controls. Is that correct?
Yes, it's fairly easy.
Yeah, like any... like the timings and the nominal values for sensors, because okay, those are going to change.
That's good, because I know in the future, things will evolve as different groups come in and we always learn as we blow up stuff.
You guys, could you make this more complicated? Is that possible?
We haven't even gotten to the separate operating system with Regal.
Oh gosh. Okay, so each state have, as you guys saw from the each state have set valves chosen to be on and off, and just for safety precautions, we're comparing that, against like each state every single time. So as we transition to different states, we have to change the valve configuration so that we'll just double check with that. Also, we are keeping track, since we have like the current state and the previous state, we always like checking to make sure we are transitioning to the correct state. And that's very good, because we don't want to like transition to a state that we should not be at. So that's for the actuator controller. So handling the commands and data packet, the sequence go as I mentioned that the Marinette data package have a key, and that key being 3F99. It's just specific values we chose. And basically, we'll get that data and save it into our buffer, and basically just run a function that checks how many items are in that data that we're receiving. If we get one, then we assume it's the user command, but we run it through a switch statement to make sure and continue. If it's the data packet, then it should have 31 items with the key value.
Quick question, do you share like a header packet between the BeagleBone Python and this, or are they just completely independent? And when you want to update one, you have to update both independently?
What do you mean?
Yeah, sorry, that wasn't clear to me.
I'm sorry. So I want to change the packet. I've got a new valve I'm adding, or a new state or a new sensor. And so I'm going to change the 31 package. I have to update both independently, I assume.
And the Marionette, yeah.
Yeah.
Right, of course, the Marionette has got to sample it. Yeah, okay, thanks.
Right. You change the Marionette and the actuator controller for how many packets is checking, and that should be it. So basically from each state, we just grab a data packet from, we check the commands to make sure to check if any commands have changed, trying to transition to a different state. And we also get a data packet and basically process it, which means splitting the sensor values and making sure if we are in the nominal value range. So that was for handling commands and data packets. And we can go into the GUI side. So a graphical user interface was delivered to the end user for easier understanding of all the parameters needed for this project. So the GUI is composed of a main window, which contains a help button, a PNID window button, a shutdown for emergencies button, alongside with an output window to display all the actuator controller communication, and an input box where the user can introduce the commands needed to control the test stand. The PNID window is composed of a diagram. So it's composed of a diagram of the PNID with sensor boxes and valve position indicators. You can tell that the boxes that have the pressure and temperature sensors, temperature for Celsius and pressure for kilopascals. So last but not least, the help window contains all the commands, valid transitions. This window right here, it contains all the command valid transitions and the meaning of the different colors used in the design. So the GUI is using Tkinter, which is a Python package, which handles all the graphical user interface, which basically works as a thin object-oriented layer. And the communication is done with a Python library known as Paramico, as we were talking about. And Paramico is a Python implementation of the SSH protocol, which provides both client and server functionality. So a file name log_GUI.txt will be saved at the same folder where the GUI script will be located for troubleshooting purposes, containing all the communication between all the systems. Just a quick note, there's two different versions to the GUI. One is for Windows and the other one's for Linux.
Where's the all on command? So I can turn on literally all the valves and kill everybody.
yeah.
Okay. Sorry. Moving on.
The vent liquid oxygen into the small room button.
Exactly right. This is great.
So
actually, I just have to ask. So instead of having separate on or off commands, you literally have a command for every single valve. So PF-PV L03 on is the command to turn on the main LOX valve, right?
Yeah.
When I'm in test check valve modes. Okay.
Yeah, for now. And to be able to do this, you have to be on the valve check state number.
Right.
So we don't want to be turning.
Yep. That's almost like arm and disarm, but that's fine.
Yeah, and this was because LFETS wanted to do the valve check just to make sure that everything works before we actually start pressurizing stuff.
No, this is great. This is like good debugging.
When we were talking with LFETS too, it sounds like they're gonna, like, rather than use the ignition sequence, they're gonna want to do the initial cold runs with these manual valve commands because they're not sure that it won't explode.
Right.
So yeah.
That makes sense.
So just because things sometimes, you know, kind of like hang and have bugs, so I added a reset command to reset the actuator controller and another reset for the marionette itself.
Okay, good.
So yeah, those are all the commands for the GUI and that are basically used on the BeagleBone AI too. And that's pretty much.
What does square valve? What does that mean?
Oh, if you go to the PNID, Josh. No, yeah. Dan. No, Dan. Yeah, see the little squares next to the valves?
Yes.
That's indicating whether they're open, closed, or in error.
Right. Green for open, blue for close, and red for error.
That's why we put the valve indicator sensors through the marionette also.
Yeah, that makes sense. I'm sorry though, how many the valve indicator tower with the four levels on it, right? That's like a summary of all the valves. Like if all the valves are in the right state, it's green. Or if they're all off, it's...
No, if all of the valves are in the correct state, it'll show the a specific binary code saying that it is in this state. And then if it goes to another state, it'll say it's in this other state. If it goes into an error, it'll go through and say like which valve is an error and display that with another code.
So these are like LED blink codes with a tower.
Yeah.
Whew.
Yeah, and if there's multiple valves that are in error, it goes through a specific priority list, meaning like if it
cycles through
the main valve, like that's obviously going to show up first.
Right. Okay, we'll get there. Gotcha.
You know, Andrew, listening to this, it's rather complicated, and I almost think we need a general operating. I'm serious. If someone first coming on, if they hadn't been through a lot of this with the team and a lot of questions, they almost need an overview operating manual.
But yeah, they absolutely do. And that's one of the things that this team was supposed to write, and we're going to fire them all and fail them. So they have to come back and write that manual because they did the exact thing I told them not to do, which is they worked all the way to the very end and got the system done and didn't focus on the user's manual and all that kind of documentation. That said, I forgive you because I wanted this damn thing done. So I don't know how I do not know how you managed to win best capstone without writing a user's manual, but that's okay.
On that note, I'm leaving this Zoom meeting and you'll never hear from me ever again.
All right, this is great. Keep and you're right, Ed. And when I meet with them tomorrow, and we go over this a bit, I hope to start that process actually. But this video is the start of that manual to some extent. This is the onboarding video. Keep going, guys.
We'll have the old, that old firing procedure that we can build off of too.
Okay.
Even though everything's changed.
To be fair, part of the reason why the documentation got pushed back was because of the complications with the rocket room, and so we only just were able to test stuff.
And oh, by the way, you have a volunteer team of mechanical engineers that you're blocked on, and oh, by the way, your test end doesn't work, and oh, but yeah. I know. We don't really blame you. We just like making fun of you. All right, keep going.
Okay, so that's pretty much for the software on my side. Do you want to take it from here, Seth?
Yeah. I'm gonna just pull up the Marionette GitHub and walk through that for now, I think.
Sorry, just so I know, who was in charge of obviously Josh was in charge of the BeagleBone AI code, the Python script. Who was in charge of the AC C code?
A lot of it was inherited from Austin, and then Josh also modified it.
Right. Okay.
I modified pretty much like all the transitionings and the mm-hmm. communication side of it.
Okay, and that is all written in C. And it's all written in the STM IDE. What's it called?
Cube. STM32Cube or something.
Cube IDE, yeah.
Cube IDE, that's right. Okay, good. So that whole thing, it works. And did you do that on a Windows box or a Linux box?
I did that on Windows.
Okay, all right. Okay, thanks. And sorry, and you've got the Cube IDE project checked into Git and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, it has you can see it has several revisions.
Yep. Yeah, I saw. Okay, good. Thanks.
Okay. So the Marionette is running on Chibi OS, and there's a lot going on here, and I don't understand all of it, and we don't need to understand all of it. Most of the actual, like, Marionette specific stuff lives here. And we'll go over that in a second. And then we will go into that, right? Not there. No, it should be in here. Sorry. Okay. So most of the individual commands are these fetch commands, and those get parsed over. So the Marionette presents itself to the host computer as a USB Type-C device, and you send commands to it serially, and those get parsed by this Regl script. So I inserted my own set of commands for this revision into the Regl script, and we're basically like bypassing all of what they built in. And then the drivers that I added go into here. So this is all a bunch of, this is for the Chibi OS's hardware abstraction layer. So this is all assembly level stuff basically. And then we've got, these are all the individual commands, right? And or drivers. So I inserted a help command just basically to see that.
So let's take a giant step back just so everybody knows. Marionette is a data acquisition or DAC system. It's a separate project. It's got an STM32 running Chibi OS. It talks USB to any Linux box. And you talk to it over UART, USB UART, okay? And so you guys are using that functionality, that raw functionality of grab ADC data and GPIO data and set GPIO data, all that stuff you're using. And you guys also added a custom block to run a SPI ADC that you added, correct?
Yeah, well, I had to revise the built-in stuff for the ADC stuff, because the way that it passes the values back was not super useful to us. So I just modified the way that it passes the values back. And I also combined all of the, it gives you access to two different ADC channels with seven ports each. And so I combined those. So we get 14 ADC channels through the STM32 on the Marionette. And this is more driver stuff.
Yeah, okay. And more in general, it is connected to the BeagleBone AI, if that wasn't clear.
Yes. So this is the part where I'm doing ADC things, mm-hmm. basically. And then I send the package back with our key, and that's that. And then this initialization stuff is going to mostly contain stuff for the spy. The ADC stuff I have configured up above. And this is just a reset command in case it hangs up so that we can like try to reset it at a hardware level, or sorry, a software level, rather than turning the whole thing off and then on. And then this is the little spy driver that I wrote and I need to test. Basically, we're just gonna send the command word to the ADC that we've got. And then the ADC that we picked has 16 channels on it. And it'll spit back all 16 values at once. And then I'm just gonna packet that and send it back over to the Beagle Bone AI with the other data packet, assuming this all works. So this isn't tested yet. The 14 channels are tested and they work fine. And once this is working, that'll give us access to another 16 channels. This is only communicating with one of the ADC chips. So that gives us the 30 sensors that we have implemented right now. We did include on the sensor frontend board a second ADC chip with another 16 channels. So there are 16 unused channels right now. And it would be pretty easy to include a second spy channel into the driver when that's all working.
Josh, would you mind doing a quick walkthrough of your code in the repo too after this?
Yeah, sure.
So any questions? This is all in ChibiOS stuff. So if you know ChibiOS, it's pretty straightforward. Otherwise, it's similar to C++, basically, with a bunch of assembly definitions.
A couple quick questions on this. So you've written the code but not tested it yet.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I just need to go into the lab to test it. It's not that complicated, so it won't take me that much longer to get it working.
Great.
But I needed a power supply and I don't have one.
Maybe we'll deal with that tomorrow. Okay. All right. Cool. Thank you. Yeah, actually, Josh, if you'd bring up the Cube IDE, I should have asked you about that earlier, just to show what that looks like. And
I should probably talk through one more thing, which is flashing the Marionette.
Yes, please.
I'll update this repo because the repo has instructions how to do that, and those are not correct. You need a DFU, a program called DFU utility. And there's a button on the Marionette that you can hold down to put it into DFU boot mode, and then you can flash it through your command line. But you do have to compile the Regal stuff separately and ahead of time before you flash it. So I'll update the Marionette documentation with that.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll give you guys a quick run through on the repo side. So we have the actuator controller firmware, which is for the Cube IDE. That's where we can change anything if we have to. Obviously different revisions that we have gone through. This actuator controller test folder was the first attempt for LFETs. They needed just to do some bulb turning on and off. But the software test folder contains three different Python scripts, and this AC it would just communicate with the AC itself, and it would do all the commands that you have already available. The Marinette that tests, it will basically request data packets, and it would just print it on the screen so you see what they look like. And this SPS is, it would check how many samples per second we get in. This is all on the software test side. For the BeagleBun software, this is the one that basically joins the Marinette and the actuator controller. Yes. So now I'm gonna share Cube ID. If you guys want to see the code on the GUI or the BeagleBun AI script, just let me know. I can go through it with you guys. So this is what Cube ID looks like. This is the main project that we have, and all the files are under core source. This is all the files for all the different states, and under INC is the header files that we need. So do you guys want to see anything in particular?
No, okay. So to program this, you just connect it to the Nucleo board, and then you run, you do basically compile program, right?
Yeah, you right click, you first create a project, you select your Nucleo board, because it's different versions of it. Mm-hmm. And once you created the project, you right click on the project, and you can run as STM32, and that will write it, or you can debug it. And that would just go through the debugging sequence.
Yeah, so I thought you checked in, you don't check in the project as well, the Cube IDE project?
Check in, what do you mean?
Into Git? Like isn't, so I only saw it.
Yes, it is. Let me show you.
I think the project just adds a configuration file, if I'm remembering correctly.
Right. And I, just because I changed different stuff through, like I basically dumped the whole thing. And
oh, there it is. Okay, that's what I didn't see before. Good. All right, thanks.
It's on the core.
Okay, good.
So yeah, this is all the different states.
No, that's good. That's all we need to see. I just want to make sure that we saw it in the context of Cube IDE.
Right.
If you could just open up one of the states and show how the valve power is defined, and then where like timing and sensor data is.
Yeah. So for example, the safety state. So here we define like which valves are gonna be on or off. In this case, they're all gonna be off for the safety state. We run to like a state configuration kind of checking. We initialize the state, like setting like current state, because safety is the first state that we get into. We process commands, and this will happen through every single of the states that we have. We grab the data packet from the FIFO and basically just continue looping through it. Once when we receive a command here in messages, this is a callback function to the interrupt sequence that the HAL drivers have, and we'll basically read until we see the carriage return, and we'll store that in a buffer, just call RX buffer, and then from there we can just basically parse and make sure like which command is it and what we have to do. I set up like different messages for like unauthorized transitions and stuff like that to keep people from trying to transition to different. The LFETs wanted a transition to safety state from every single state. So I enabled that for them, but yeah. For the initialization of the automatic sequence, which happens on ignition, we go through the same thing, but we this time define a timeout because we want to run through different times, and we'll count until that time and run basically set it up to transition to the next state. And that's how it will transition to all the states and end up on safety. Do you guys have any questions? Sweet.
No, thank you.
On the, let's see. On the GUI side, we have two different versions for Linux and Windows. And basically we have the-
Why?
I set it up that way just because it was a little bit different for Linux. And I had it before, I had it joined together, but I don't know, I thought maybe it was cool.
Okay. So you had to do something different in Windows just to get it to work, even though it's a Python Tinker script.
They have slightly different libraries available.
Yeah.
Windows is like PyServal.
Yeah, it's different. Okay.
All right.
The whole thing is different. For the GUI, we use threading. Threading worked out fine.
Threading?
It's a multi-threading Python package.
Threading. Okay, gotcha. Yeah.
Yeah. And basically here you can see the rundown for the Tkinter side where you set like text and labels. These are for the ball positions. And this function was very useful. This function will resize the image. Like if you have like a background image and you want to resize your windows, it will resize the image and it won't look weird. If you don't use this, then the image doesn't resize at all.
Nice.
And this is the Paramigo side where you declare like host name, username, password. So that it
thank you for making sure it's in the code, checked in. That's good. Okay.
Yeah. but yeah, that's for the GUI side. And for the Python script that is on the BeagleBone AI. On this Python script, we use multi-processing.
Why is the BeagleBone Python script in the same folder as the actuator controller?
I added there just, and I noted outside here, like includes BBAI Python script. I don't know, because maybe somebody wanted to grab it right away, but I have a dedicated folder for all the revisions to the BeagleBone.
Right. In general, that's a really bad idea. Because that's what Git is for, and Git labels and things like that. You have your on master is what you've got, published, right, and released. And then there's no reason to have the old ones because that's what Git is for. It's fine that you have it, but it's not very Git like. I'm surprised that it will make the BeagleBone script harder to find. Because it's in the actuator controller, which is where you don't expect it to be. So that's some feedback, but that's fine. We can change that later. There's no rush.
Okay. For the script that is on the BeagleBone AI, we had to use multi-processing. And the reason why was because to be able to keep up, I don't know, I tried with motor treading and it was like fighting the rider tread that is basically printing everything for the actual controller. So the samples per second on the marionette tread will basically decrease a lot. So I transitioned to multi-processing just for better concurrency. And so here we have, this is the marionette process where we go through all the setup on the marionette. This is how we open the port on the marionette. And have in mind that this is basically running two different serial ports at the same time. This is the actuator controller process. And I'm checking for serial number just in case we decide to add another Nucleo next time.
Yes, good idea. Excellent. Right. It'll happen.
And all the reading. This is the writer process. This function basically sends the commands to the actuator controller. And this function is the one that writes everything that is ready. It's always looking to see if there's anything ready to be printed. And yeah, this is all the commands. Do you guys have any questions?
Nope. Not until we actually try modifying it, then we'll come hunt you down wherever you are. You'll be in deep Alaska and working on some secret project and we'll come hunt you down on Caribou. Anyway.
Yeah, can we figure out, Andrew, how we can rescind the degree?
Go back in time. All right, excellent. Holy shit, you guys. This is a little, it's just whenever you're doing a presentation and there's a lack of questions, there's two reasons why. One is everybody understands it, it's fine. The second is it's so complicated and overwhelming that nobody can think of a single question to ask right now because they have to jump into it. So that's where we are right now, is it's just a big, complicated old system. But this is good. Recording this will be a big deal. Okay, let's move on.
Do you want me to go through hardware? Boards?
I want to make sure we've covered all the software so far. We did the block diagram, we talked about the software. So the valve indicator board is missing and we've not gone over any parts of that.
Katie worked on that. I could go over it at a high level if you want.
Yeah, that would be great. Let's just touch on that. Okay. Jennifer, I don't know if you could ping Katie and ask if she could show up.
I will ping.
I'm kind of surprised she's not.
Me too. Okay. Oh, I don't think she's pushed her most recent version, but I think that it was just pin definitions that changed since there. This is the file system that she used. It's pretty straightforward. It does add some RTOS stuff because mm-hmm. Because we wanted to be able to save timestamps and stuff, but it's really lightweight.
So this is not ChibiOS. This is STM32 Core, I think they call it, which is this pseudo operating system. It's more like a lightweight threading interface, you know?
Yeah, so, okay. Exactly, yeah.
Okay. All right. So she also used STM32 IDE, Cube IDE, correct?
Yes.
Okay, can you go up to current 4 code for just a minute?
VI.
And go to I want to make sure that she's committed her project stuff, but I don't see it, unfortunately.
This is the config file, I know.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
I don't see. Oh, sorry, I didn't remember that. Okay, then excellent. That's all.
Yeah. This contains the pin mapping, and this is This is stuff about the hardware itself, I think. But this is the main part of the project.
Good. That, yeah, the pin configuration and that is good. Okay, thank you. That's all we need.
Yeah. And then these are stuff to support the FATFS, I'm pretty sure. And then the actual state machine and stuff is all in main. Prototypes. So this is a file to keep track of all of the different states and stuff.
Okay.
This is to keep track of time, the RTOS stuff. Yeah, I think this is all just support functions. Oh yeah, no, we took this out. I think we took the battery out of the valve indicator. Yeah. And then this is the main function, which is just checking all of the physical states of the valves. So we're just running through all of the different valves and checking if any of them are mismatching.
So you indicated earlier that you were checking the battery. Now you're saying you removed the battery indicator?
That was something else. We had originally had a battery backup system, and it would indicate if it was running off the battery power, but we eliminated that.
We had to switch to a different STM32 because of silicon shortage, and this one didn't have an easy way to check that.
Great, thanks. Let's move on.
Move on from this?
Yeah.
You don't want to look at this anymore?
No, I think we're good.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. So, hardware. So this, again, all in the SAR hardware folder. First off, I'm just gonna go briefly over a couple of these. I think there's only two or three boards that are actually complicated and important. So PoE input board, again, this is getting all of the 24 volt power reconnect plus, and it's splitting it off to the various boards. They are labeled on the silt screen, which of these two pin headers are going where. And they're all standardized. The positive is the left pin, ground is the right. And then the BeagleBone AI is just mounted on top right here. So this is the PoE input port. It's just a little barrel jack, and we have their one regulator on there.
While we're on this board, I should probably point out that I probably fried the 24 volt PoE injector. We opened it up and took a look at it and couldn't find anything fried, but I definitely applied a reverse current to it and it doesn't seem to be working anymore.
Wait, reverse current, how?
So we couldn't find the power supply for it. So we're putting some lithium polymer batteries in series, as one does, to get to 48 volts.
Oh my God.
And I wanted it to work.
You mean 24 volts?
No, you need 48 volts for the
input. Okay, for the PoE, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh my God, okay. And, yeah, you killed it.
And I might have done that backwards.
Yeah, maybe you did.
All right, well, that sucks. That was a very expensive piece of hardware.
Okay, we'll figure it out.
All right, next board. I'm gonna go through the lockout tagout boards because they're super straightforward. So this is just the same circuit repeated over and over 9 times. So you have a 5-volt input, which is coming off of the main battery because the battery we did have had a 5-volt USB regulator coming off of it. But it just needs 5 volts, and all that is powering is these LEDs. and it is isolated, so you don't have any false signal going to the logic board. So all that this is, you have these two pins right here, and that's where you hook up the key switch. So it's either on or off. And when it is on, it sends that output signal onto this header, which goes into the logic board. And it's just either green or red for being on or off, so that on the actual board, you can have a little LED indicator. Even though if the key is in there or not, like, it's pretty obvious, but it's just an extra safety thing. And it's all surface mount. I think if someone wants to go in and do like individual boards, I cut it on the LBKF in the EPL just for convenience, which is why I did it all through hole.
So the status of this board is I need to put those PDE5 E1s on the board. Those just came in this week. And otherwise it should be good.
All right, and then there's the logic board. So it has that same header that's coming off of those key switches, and that's just going into these two AND gates networks. So once all of them are on, then it will send an okay over to these networks, which just give it power from the main battery going to these two headers. And this gets a little complicated in the wiring. I think going through a physical walkthrough will be helpful because we do have those commercial off-the-shelf PoEs, and then we also have the emergency stop and the power switch for those two. So you can have all the keys in the lockout tagout box and you still have to press the buttons to send power to those modules.
This board is fully assembled and we tested it and it looks good. It's not on the test stand because the keyboard wasn't finished, but it's done pretty much.
Yeah, that's something that the next team will probably have to do is finish up the actual physical construction of the lockout tagout box, because I did laser cut a box like last year, but it doesn't fit everything and it needs to be updated and cut. So on the physical board, there's that header that's coming from the lockout key switches, and then these pins that are going to the buttons and then also to the other POEs. Those are all labeled. A couple different sheets on this. Just a quick refresher, this board has an STM32 processor on it, and it is reading these Hall effect sensors to sense the valve positions, whether they're open or closed or in error. And it's also receiving the current state of the test stand, and it is comparing those. If anything is not matching, it will throw up an error code on an LED tower, which has red, orange, green, and blue LEDs. Katie is also here, so they can go over the code briefly too, if we'd like. But first off, I'm not sure what the resolution is like on this, so I might zoom in a little more. The first sheet is just these power regulators. So it's getting 24 volts from that PoE input board. It steps it down to 3.3 and 10 volts. And everything is labeled like where those voltages are supplying power to. And I also have LEDs on all of the different outputs so that we know.
Yeah, so Jennifer,
just visually. We no longer have a battery backup. That is left over from a previous design.
So Jennifer, do you hear me? I had a question.
Next, we have the processor and SD card. We're just using this little micro SD just to back up the valve position data. We have an extra header on our board, and this is just all of the unused pins on the STM processor. Added that to...
You guys use an L476?
Yeah, it was all that was in stock.
Oh my God.
The silicon shortage made us change a lot of our designs.
Okay. All right.
Yeah,
Jennifer,
so
can you hear me? I had a question.
We have, yeah, the flasher here. Yeah, and then any unused pins we just put out just so that we had a little more freedom for,
good,
you know, working with the design. And then we have the inputs and outputs. So these are all of the Hall effect sensors. This specific design is important. We do have the 10 volts and the 3.3. That is very much on purpose. It's just the way that the Hall effect sensor is built. We need to supply more power, but we couldn't have 10 volts obviously going directly into the STM because that would be bad. And a quick note on the Hall effect sensors.
Sorry, they're all, did you say open collector? They're all open collector?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. The sensors that we're using, they are, what was it called? So they are triggered and then they have to, triggered by like the north pole of a magnet, and then they have to be exposed to the south pole to be turned off. So we have two magnets on the valves, or on the top of the valve, just so that we can turn it on and off.
Okay.
Good. We have this UART pin header here, and that's just coming from the actuator controller. And again, that is just sending the current state from the actuator controller to this board. This board does not send anything to the actuator controller. It's just receiving that data.
Good job putting the 10K in. And also, is the, are you actually using CTS RTS?
Yeah.
You are? Okay, wow, all right.
Yeah. So Jennifer, do you hear me?
Okay.
I have a question.
Then lastly, we just have the output circuits, and this is just to the LED tower. And we also have a line here for the buzzer. We don't use the buzzer really, but we have it there. We have it connected just in case.
So just so you know, deep history, since 1998, PSAS has had the ability to have buzzers and sirens and all that kind of stuff. And literally never in 25 years or how long that have we ever used it. So I'm deeply proud that you did that and didn't use it. So, that's hilarious. Okay.
All right, yeah, that's it. And then we have the board itself. Everything is labeled on the silk screen. So all of the Hall effect sensors here. We just kept everything separate instead of just doing like branching off the wire specifically, because it just seemed like it would be a lot messier and we weren't sure like how long we needed to make the wire. And it, yeah, so we just kept those all split up. And a couple more Hall effect sensors here just because it ran out of space.
That's good.
This is that extra pins from the processor going out there. I did include the pinout table, and it is on GitHub if you need to know what those pins are mapped to, because I kind of just...
Pins are mapped to?
Which pins on this header are mapped to the SDMs. Huh?
It's in the schematic.
Yeah, but like if you didn't want to... You know, look at open the schematic. It's right on the GitHub. Just to do a quick reference.
Okay, that's nice. But if you don't open, if you can't open the schematic, or don't know how, you shouldn't be wiring it anyway. So, anyway, but that's
fair
fine.
Point.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. Then there's that
Jennifer,
connector to the AC board. This goes to the LED tower. It's the micro SD, and we have the barrel jack there. And there's a little STM flasher right there too.
Great.
Yeah.
Yeah, STDB. Yep.
So that's pretty much it for that board.
Will you do me one favor? Will you?
Sorry. One more thing.
Yeah.
I forgot. There's also this header. This header goes to the sensor front end board. It's just sending the valve position data over to the DAC system too.
Oh, good. So it's not like wide, it's daisy chained through this board.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Hey, people on Zoom, can you hear me? I'll take that as a no. Ed, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Okay, good. Yeah.
I just went off. I had a problem with my mic there. So I just went in and out. But I had a question a little bit earlier.
Oh, yeah.
And sorry, I just went in and out there for a minute. The question is, when you said you're using LEDs for some display for indicators,
mm-hmm.
right? So before you start any of this, do you do anything to do a LED check? Be sure that they all work in right, the colors and everything?
That would be a good question for Katie.
Because I'll tell you, if anytime you're doing any kind of test, and if you're using lights as indicators, you should always, the first thing you do, check the lights, sure they work.
The valve indicator board, the software has a sequence that it runs before it goes into the functional mode where it checks the buzzer, the LEDs, and the SD card. So you get a separate file written to the SD card. It goes through all the LEDs, checking different combinations, and it sees if the buzzer can go and clear.
Awesome.
Nice.
Okay, this is what I've asked. This side could be. Do you want me, Andrew, for something or?
No, I just want to make sure I didn't have to have my microphone on, so I wanted someone to.
Yeah, no, I had a problem with my mic, so I just went in and out and in rather. Zoomed in for a minute. Okay.
Any other questions on the hardware side for valve indicators? Good.
Oh, would you do me a favor before you move on?
Oh yeah.
Can you open up a data sheet of the Hall effect sensors?
Yes. Let me remember. Did I put that in here? Oh my God. Zoom, why are you like this?
One thing that will help, if you go to the Eagle control panel.
Sorry. Oh, I didn't know. Okay. Yes. What about it?
Go to the Eagle control panel. And then where it says like home or preview.
Wait, what do you mean?
You have to go to the actual control panel, which is the funny little thing. Yeah, that one. And hit preview. No, home, I guess it would be. Whichever one is that. No, down below, right above Fusion 360. Yeah.
It was hidden by the Zoom, Zoom panel.
There. That literally takes an entire core to run their little movie.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
It's super stupid. Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty dumb.
Yeah. All right, sorry, keep going. So,
I have one other question for you, Jennifer. Your Hall effect sensors, Hall effects are traditionally temperature sensitive. And I assume these are temperature compensated, but will they still work down near where the locks are going through the valves?
They should, theoretically. They shouldn't be exposed to like the piping that the locks will be passing through, because they're just going to be on like the top of the solenoids of the valves.
Well, okay, I just didn't know how cold that's going to get.
Yeah, no, they should be well separated.
Okay.
Yeah, one second.
It's US 8527.
Here we go.
Oh, it's adorable.
Oh my God, there's so many Zoom things in the way. Sorry. Oh, there we go. There it is.
Ah, okay, great. So it's got a MOSFET output, open collector with a little hysteresis and okay, great. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. See that. Yeah, and that's why we have the 10 volts here and the 3.3.
Yes,
there.
Correct.
Yeah.
Good.
Oh my gosh.
All right.
All right. Cool. I'm going to go to the actuator controller. Again, several sheets. And this one has the STM Nucleo, which is just mounted on top of the board, which is why we have these two big pin headers. You can kind of see there as well. I did make a note here that any components that are underneath that need to make sure that they don't interfere with the Nucleo being mounted on. So that's where most of the, well, all of the processing happens. Also have, again, that one pin header, which is going from this board to that valve indicator board. This one is pretty straightforward. You just have these circuits just repeated, and these are getting triggered by the processor and supplying this VBAT, which is the 24 volt power to the valves or igniters. The only weird one is there's one valve that runs at 12 volts.
Oh God.
And this is actually an issue that we need to correct. I did not find any current ratings on this valve, but apparently it takes like over 2.5 amps.
Okay.
And it fried our regulator that we have. We have one regulator that takes in the 24 volt battery, mm-hmm. sets it down to 12 volts. And it could not handle the current, and it is,
and it died.
It died real
Can
bad.
Can you go back to that regulator for a minute? Zoom in. It's a, oh, I don't know that one. MP2456, okay. Okay, but it should, what it should have done is it should have done half an amp, and then just, that's it. It should have constant currented and done all the things, but yeah, no, okay.
Yeah, right. No, it is like black and smoky.
Smoky.
And, yeah.
All right.
So yeah, we'll need to replace that. If we can't find a regulator that can actually fit on this board, we could probably just do either a separate board that's right next to the solenoid relay that is connected to that 12 volt PoE and supplies that 24 volt mm-hmm. battery power. We could just attach it over there, like separate from the board. Or if we can find a regulator. I'm assuming that one that would be rated for that high of current would not be able to fit under the Nucleo like this one is.
No, but we could debug it and find a place for it. So yeah, that will be a patch that will. Okay.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah. I think that's it for that. Again, on the board, those pin headers. We should also look into replacing these small transistors. Because apparently they were having issues dying. And I think it's
the Q10 that's right there.
Yeah, these little ones.
Why were they dying?
They weren't dying when we were operating or testing anything. It was just, I don't know.
You have to replace a ton of them.
Are they not ready to 24 volts?
No, they died getting baked off the board for some reason. So you have to replace them.
Yeah, it's some temperature thing, like maybe when they were just being
okay,
in the FL oven. Yeah, it was strange. Okay. I think okay. We should just replace them or something.
Okay.
There is also one weird issue on this board.
Sorry,
I think it was.
Question, are those SOT23s or SC70s too?
It's 23.
Great.
Yeah.
Good, that'll be easy.
Yeah. I can't remember exactly where it is, but there's one spot that should be grounded, but it's not. So I was just going to add another via, but it's just weird because it's connected to ground on the board and in designs and everything, it's just not on like the physical board. So we just had to add a wire from one of these pins to another one of the pins.
Okay.
It was just strange.
Yeah, I'm surprised you didn't see that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, there's also LEDs off of all of these so that if the valve should be getting power, it'll light up an LED, and that was mainly just so when we're testing, we didn't have to actually put a load on or like, you know, hit it with a voltage meter. So those are all there. They are labeled SOV 1, 2, and 3 and stuff. I think the next rev we should actually replace that silkscreen label with the actual valve names on the PNID. Any questions?
I'll go back to the sheet for a second. No.
Good. Okay. All right. I think there's just one more board, the sensor front end. So between the sensors and the marionette. This is one of the more complicated ones. So sheets First sheet is just regulators. We have, like, again, everything's labeled, so it should be, I did not put like where the power is going, but oh well. So we have the 3.3 regulator, we have 5 volts coming from the PoE input board, and 12 volts. Oh, I did label them.
Yeah,
that's good. what was that again? Right, that was the other PoE input. We have...
Sorry, can you go back to what you just were showing for a minute and zoom in on that? Does that really say minus 24? No, okay, it was just an error. Okay, never mind. Yeah.
So we have the rest of these sheets are just sensors. Because it's going to the marionette, there are two of these 40-pin headers. One of them is analog and one of them is digital. And that just, we have the raw signals going into the analog, which just goes into the marionette's analog to digital converter. And then on these ones, we have our own ADCs. So it's already converted into SPI and we're just sending that over that header. So for the analog sensors, we have a connector coming from the thrust plate amplifier, and that's those four load cells. And we also have that power pin because we're sending 12 volts to the amplifier from this board. And then we have all of our pressure sensors. And this setup was from last year's capstone. We didn't need to change anything because it worked fine. We just changed.
And these are all 420 milliamps. That's
good. Yes. Okay. Yeah. And I have the part numbers there. It's, yeah, the 4 to
good.
20. And then they're all labeled for the specific PNID reference and the pressure rating. And yeah, that's it for that. For digital, we have our thermocouples and the Hall effect sensors. So this header is coming from the valve indicator board. And again, it's just sending that same data over to the DAC. And those are going into one of our, let's see, one of our analog to digital converters.
Oh, why'd you put it into the analog digital converter with the digital signals?
Huh.
We have to read the whether it's on or off somewhere. It's a digital.
Guess we can convert it to SPI.
Oh, so we use it like a SPI GPIO input, right? The digital input. Okay, that's that's funny and fine. Okay. You didn't have any marionette digital signals left.
No, we didn't. Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay. All right. I forgive you all.
Then we have our these K-type thermocouples. We have these little amplifier circuits. This is just straight out of the data sheet. And those are also going over the ADC. We have a second ADC, which is just all of these extra sensors.
Jennifer?
Yes?
Don't ever wire through the chips.
Why?
Because you just don't.
Okay.
Always go around. We'll make you like do 3 Hail Marys later.
Okay, that's right. Fine.
What?
That's
right.
Yeah, we do have extra signal lines available if we need them.
Great.
There's the board. So these are just we just have like ribbon cables which go from this board to the marionette for these two headers. Everything else, we're just using those regular, two pin connectors for everything. So these are all the temperature sensors over here. And there's the extra sensors there, the Hall effect sensors there, and then the thrust plate amplifier there. And then these are the pressure sensors. Yeah. Any questions?
Actually, I have a question for Andrew. Andrew, I may have asked you this question a couple of years ago, and I don't remember the answer. Do we copyright any of our PCBs?
Sorry, I'm thinking about that. Yes, but indirectly, because everything's released under the CERN 2.0 open source license, where we claim the copyright but give you open source, viral open source rights to it. So no, we don't do that on the circuit board or in the design, but there is a license file in the root of the directory.
Okay, because yeah. I was just looking at it, and I didn't see it on there. I'm used to seeing a copyright, but that's, yeah. And I know we talked about this over a year ago, and I didn't remember the answer.
Yeah, no. Theoretically, we ought to do that now that you mention it, but I don't think it matters because we've got the license agreement as legal backup.
So. Okay. It's just something, Jennifer, when you go into real world, mm-hmm. you're going to expect a copyright on there.
Yeah, that's right.
I haven't done that for any of the boards that I've done at my job yet.
They should.
I think the only people that see it are the customer and us,
right.
Because it's all ITAR anyway.
Right, that's probably right.
That's it for the boards. Here, let me pull up the...
What about the lotto? That's not ready to look at.
Oh, we already went over that. Yeah, we went over it yesterday.
Oh yeah, I totally remember that. Okay. All right, good.
I'm just pulling up the drive. Sure. All right, PSAS share drive. So all of our stuff is inside of the LFETS folder. And there's a SAR folder in here.
There's a folder in there called software? That's not you guys though.
That's not us.
Okay, good.
We have a couple of archives, last year's capstone, and then our capstone. We could definitely have been better about organizing this. We have some of our bombs, some of our presentations. We have that state sheet that I showed yesterday. And nice. There is this, which is just like a quick summary of all of the sensor inputs and where they are and what they go to and what they're mapped to. It's just like to help between
nice.
Software and
yeah. good
stuff.
Because this is not complicated or anything.
Yeah, just a quick reference because it's kind of all over the place.
Yeah, it's good.
Capstone
inventory, do we care about that?
That was, we don't really. That was just to help us figure out what we needed to buy at some point.
Okay, and then all the, you guys still have those boxes of the PSBA, right?
I have a lot of them, but there's a couple there.
Okay, I'm going to go back later this afternoon and grab them. If it's okay with you guys, I'll actually bring them back here. Okay.
Yeah.
And then let's start a wire rack shelf just for SAR.
Ooh, so special.
I know, yes. Okay.
Here's some valve indicator documents.
Oh, we opened up the software for the flowchart.
This was from 4.11. So you've probably seen this because that was for your class.
Oh, it was 4.11. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Never mind. Then that's fine. That's not what you guys actually did. So, okay.
This was just purchase request stuff. That's just UTEEP things. Not super interesting. We have a bunch of pictures that we need to upload more of.
Yeah.
We have a lot.
It would be great to have more media.
And then here's some, this was like some leftover stuff that we had to update, some more like pin connections. Again, this is all in that summary sheet too.
Okay.
And then just some other power reference stuff, just because we're interconnecting a lot of different regulators between different boards. This document was given to us by LFETS just to give us like the pressure ratings that we needed to have, the voltage current, for the sensors when we were trying to figure out what parts we needed. So, what that is. Oh, yeah. Yeah, and then just a bunch of our diagrams, some left over from a few years ago. I think the most recent one is still this system architecture, which is just all of our block diagrams that we made.
So Andrew, I do have a question. I think we mentioned at the last meeting that there was no cable diagram. Do we need one?
No. No, they actually did well. These cross-reference sheets are kind of what we need. We'll basically reverse engineer it as we need it. I think that they did a good enough job naming these things that we're gonna be okay.
Okay.
Cool. And this is completely up to date. This is all of the parts that we purchased for the different boards and the different sensors and everything.
That's up to date.
Yes.
Great.
Yeah, it was a pain to go through all those emails and find everything.
Yes.
It was very boring.
There's
and a star I bomb did try to link everything on there too.
What's the UT star bomb?
This is everything we spent for the last like year.
All right.
And everything we purchased.
Make a UT folder and put all the UT stuff in there.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'll do that later.
We'll keep that. Yeah. So this is what I'd love you guys to do, even though you are hereby released to the winds, right? But what I'd really like is I'd like a folder that says capstone, and that's got all your capstoning things in it, 411, 412, 413, anything that's got to do with capstone. And then a folder for the UTEEP, that's all the UTEEP stuff. And then on the root folder is all the stuff for
design yeah, stuff. Exactly. Okay, yeah, that's easy.
Okay, that'd be great.
So Andrew, when do we have to submit the budget stuff for the UTEEPs?
No, they're done.
Okay, because I thought we had to show outside support and all that. Because
did you got the letters of support, right?
Like at the beginning of UTEEP.
I was supposed to do something.
There's two more things you need to do.
Okay.
You need to check in with Alex or whoever the DRA is to make sure there's no money left over, which I think there's no.
There's none. I already did that. Yeah.
The second thing is you need to get the matching letters from whoever we're using to match the funds with. They need to give you a signed letter.
Mm-hmm.
Was it you, Ed?
Yeah.
I think I was on Czar.
Okay, yeah, you
were right.
So we need a letter from Ed and whoever else.
I think it was just Ed.
Really? Okay, that's great. It should be in the UTEEP folder. Anyway, so get the letter, and then you'll need to send that to Alex or whoever the DRA is for this. And then
I can't get that today, just so you know, or tomorrow. I'm very busy the next 2 days. I got a little bit of an emergency. I have something. A washing machine broke down. I got to run out and buy one.
That is an emergency. We need it by about June 20th.
Okay, fine. That's no problem.
Yeah.
And then we have to do a report too, right?
Yes. July 31st or July 30th, whatever it is. There's a report due, and then
our capstone report was like 50 pages.
So usually the capstone reports become they get rebranded as the OSGC reports.
We were very good. Thorough.
yeah, that's good. And then the last thing is someone has to be here in November to give the actual presentation down in Corvallis.
Okay.
Hopefully one of you guys will. We can always rope in an unfortunate undergraduate to do that, but it's better if one of you three are here and can do that.
I will absolutely fly out for that.
Oh,
it'll be
nice.
Fun.
Actually, it is super fun because you get to see all the space kids, you know, down in Corvallis. So it's good. It's kind of fun.
Awesome. I'll be in Point One too.
Nice.
You guys should all come.
Yeah,
absolutely.
For sure.
It's good networking too.
Is there anything else that we need to go over other than the walkthrough?
Hold on, let me actually think about this for a minute. No.
Yes, I just found my old letter, and I guess what I have to do is justify $3,000,
40
hours at $75 an hour is what I have in my head.
Let's take this offline.
Okay.
Good, thanks.
You just edit the video.
That's right. it's above board. You don't need to talk about it on YouTube.
Right, I just want to know. That's what I have in there.
Yeah,
so.
That's good. Okay. No, I think that's it. We've gone over the boards. We've gone over the software. We've gone over how things are put together. We've got this mappings.
We need to go over the BI software in more depth than I did yesterday.
That's right.
That's not a bad idea. Katie, do you mind taking 5 minutes or so and going over the software on the valve indicator?
Yeah, I could go over it real quick. I tried to keep it simple, so I should be able to do it quickly.
Oh, that's great. Do you mind sharing your screen and going over the code?
Yeah, I got it pulled up, so if I can figure out how to... Okay. So valve indicator board. So I tried to keep it simple. So all the functions it does are all modular. So like the valves can be added to it easily or taken away. And
hold on for a second, Katie. I mean, take you up 10,000 feet for just a minute before you start. So this is a STM32 cube IDE environment, and you're doing it all under STM32 cube. Is there any other operating system or anything else that or this relies on?
No, I just used the cube IDE.
Okay, great. Thank you. Keep going.
Okay. So basically, valve indicator board, it writes to an SD card. It takes in from the Hall effect sensors. It compares stuff. So this function, so this will add to the SD card. It takes in what the values are currently, what they're expected to be, and just writes that down so you have that for future reference. It just basically just writes in a way that's easy to read. Main check is basically checking for errors in the valve. So it's comparing expected results to current results or current values. And it basically is looking for errors, seeing which valves are in error. If a valve in error is found, then it finds which valves are in error. And it marks that. I'm gonna see if I can find. So it turns the buzzer on when there's an error. And that buzzer does not go off until the error is cleared. How it tells you which valves are in error is it basically takes the valve states are assigned a number and it displays that over binary. So basically we have the sort of functions as a decimal to binary converter, and then it displays that over the LEDs. That's old code for the power failure state, which we don't currently have working in it. So this is the testing I was talking about. So at the start of the valve indicator board, when it starts out, it tests all the different parts of it just to make sure that your SD card is working, all the LEDs are showing, the buzzer's turning on, all that fun stuff. And it's just checking different values to see if we have no errors, if one's an error, if two are an error, if all of them are an error, and then cleared. And then this current version of it that I have pulled up isn't checking the actual states that are coming from the actuator controller. Instead, what this one is doing is it's showing you which valves are open. It's the current version that I have pulled up here. And then I have the algorithm down here for how it works.
Awesome.
Yeah, I have one comment. On your buzzer, is there a manual way to turn that off? Because I'll tell you, if you're troubleshooting, having a loud buzzer in your ear once you know you have a problem is not helping.
Yeah, no, it's designed to be annoying.
There's no buzzer, Ed. And given PSAS history, there will never be a buzzer, so we're okay.
I doubt it, Andrew, not in this case.
Oh yeah, it's also 300 feet away.
Okay.
But that's a good point, putting a switch in line with the buzzer. Well, that's not safe, though. Yeah.
It's separate power than the valve.
Which is fine. Well, let's deal with that later. But that's a good point, because being able to temporarily disable an annoying buzzer while you debug is good.
I'll take it from me, experience.
Yeah, okay. No, currently it's not in there to disable the buzzer. It's designed to be annoying to get you to fix an error.
Yep, which is good.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's about it. Oh. And the SD card that we're using a open source library to get the SD card to write over. All that does is it just provides the function so that we can make the SDM communicate over SPI to the SD card.
Okay, so we're using the SPI mode on the micro SD card.
Yeah.
And a quick question, do you do anything special? It's a FAT32 card, right?
Yeah, it's FAT32.
And do you do anything special to close the file when you're done?
You just have to send, I can show it here, if I can find it. Oh, it just close and demount it.
Okay, and what command do we have to send it to get it to do that?
It's just this one right here, just fclose, and then use the fill that you got from the SD card.
Okay.
You know, the library, it's good in that it's designed to make things simple for reading and writing. One drawback of it, though, which I unfortunately discovered, is it doesn't like it when you have more than just the main file. So all the functions have to be declared in the main file because of how it makes its includes. It was a little bit of a hot mess to get it working, but.
Yeah, okay.
Just to let you know about something else about buzzers, if you have a buzzer that exceeds 120 decibels without ear protection, you have an OSHA problem.
Oh, I already have that.
Just thought I'd let you know, but that's the spec of our number, right?
All right. I think we're done here then. Anything else, Katie?
No, that's about it.
All right. Thank you. All right. I'm going to kill the recording. Thank you guys, nice work.
Okay, 2020-21 electrical engineering SAR capstone handoff walkthrough and operation without the dreaded, what's it called?
Air compressor,
because we're too weenies to actually run it. So here's the whole thing. This is our test stand, sorry. And let's do a walkthrough of it first.
Okay. Just kind of relating to the block diagram, we have our control laptop here.
Okay.
It's connected to our PoE, which does over here. Sorry, we have an adapter just because the laptop does not have Ethernet.
Yep.
So we have our Ethernet going into that main processor, this BeagleBone AI, which is mounted onto a PoE input board.
Hold on for a second. So yes. Usually this is PoE, but right now you don't have the PoE hooked up.
Because it was fried. So we just need to buy another
okay, PoE. That's fine. But usually this would be PoE. So I'm going to take a quick look at that. Okay, so that's the BeagleBone AI, and that's the Ethernet coming in. That would usually be, is that the PoE that would usually be running it? Or is that the other one?
That's the splitter. So we have our inductor, which is on the table over there.
Which is dead.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, but the point is that this splitter is usually the one that would run the BeagleBone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. It would just be connected with this right there.
Yeah, okay, good. Okay, and then that is currently our PoE.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so ignore the clip leads. Okay, good.
Yeah.
All right.
So we have the USB from the BeagleBone AI going into this USB hub, which just splits off power a little bit there. We have all these other power leads going to the other boards as well. So we have our marionette here. Right on the bottom, we have our AC board, and you can kind of see the Nucleo mounted onto that. It's like right on the bottom. And we have our valve indicator board, the sensor front end board there. And we do have the thrust plate amplifier. It's just mounted there temporarily just because we don't have the thrust plate currently. Mm-hmm. It is still being worked on by mechanical.
Okay, so let me do this again.
Mm-hmm.
There's our marionette board attached to the BeagleBone AI through the USB hub. And then this outer board is the valve indicator.
No, the top one is the sensor front end.
Oh, I'm sorry, okay.
Yeah.
Sensor front end, excellent. And then the one underneath that is the valve indicator. And then the one underneath that is the actuator controller.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, nothing complicated with that. Okay, good. And then test plate amplifier. Okay, good. And then this whole plate pops out with four screws, right?
Yeah, and there's also foam underneath it.
Okay.
Just because it's going to be going under a lot of vibration.
Okay. And then what comes out of this? These all go to the valves and go to the sensors, correct?
Yeah. So since the actuator control is on the bottom, all of these go to the different valves.
Okay.
Not all of the sensors are currently hooked up just because we don't need them right now. But this top board would have all of these going to all of the different sensors.
Okay, great. And then the unplugged marionette usually goes to sensor board.
Yeah, it's just that ribbon cable.
Yeah, okay, good.
Mounts right there.
All right.
And there.
Good. Okay. All right, okay. Excellent.
Oh, and the other thing we don't have hooked up right now we have one of them hooked up, but this is the 300 feet of power over Ethernet. So we have two Ethernet cables coming in and out, and that's just the 24 volts going to power most of those boards, and then we have our 12 volts, which just goes to trigger that solenoid relay to supply the 24 volt power to the valves.
Okay, so let's take a look at this.
Yeah.
So these are our 12 volt lithium ion Bluetooth batteries, because all batteries need Bluetooth in connections. That's important. And then that's the 12 volt relay that you're saying goes to this power over Ethernet.
Yeah.
Is that bypassed right now, so we can do this, or do you actually have to? You can plug it in.
I can plug it in, and it could turn the valve, like supply power to the valves, but it's just off for now.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah,
good.
We don't need it.
Okay.
And then we have our other injector.
That's the 12 volt injector for that.
Yeah.
Okay, and then right now we have no place to mount the batteries, but eventually the batteries should be mounted to the test app.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's plenty of space on the bottom that we can use. We just didn't want to clog anything up while they were still messing with the valves and the piping, and just give them that space.
I'm actually not even sure that we can actually take this thing out the door anymore. So there's a lot sticking out of this thing. I'm not sure it's going to fit. So that will be relatively hilarious.
The only other thing we still need to mount, we have the valve indicator LED tower, and then we also have the smaller tower for the power indication.
And where's that?
On the table. There it should be.
I don't see it.
It's somewhere around here. It's the same exact thing, just without the blue LED.
Okay, so it's the same thing. Okay. Okay, good.
There's going to be another structure here for all of the tanks.
Yeah.
And we're going to just have mounts onto that.
Oh, okay, that's fine. Good.
And then the software.
Okay.
Yeah.
So here we have the main window.
Okay, hold on for a second. Can you get Zoom running on this?
Zoom?
Yeah. Because maybe you should just, instead of me recording. Well, that might be okay. Hold on. Can you guys see that?
Yeah, I can see some red and a few things. I can't see any detail.
Okay, well, let's just do this. That's fine. I think that's okay.
So this is the main window.
Yeah.
Here we can see the PNID window,
with
all the sensors and the current state. And the other window is the hub window with all the commands.
Mm-hmm.
And so we can use the status command to know in which state we are. Which in safety, we can go into the valve check. And we can cycle. Oops. Just to do like an auto cycling.
Not sure what's that. Oh, the PoE is not plugged in yet.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, that makes sense tonight. Okay, so let's go ahead and plug in the PoE.
Okay.
Now, can I abort this somehow? Huh? How do I do that? By hitting shutdown?
Yeah.
Go ahead and do it. Shutdown.
Ooh, it will birch for 2 seconds, and then it will go back to safety.
Okay. You can power cycle the boards that way. That makes sense. Okay, so let's do a status check.
Something's happening. Yeah, the actual is not talking.
Oh, so should we power down?
Usually I can get it. Something's happening.
The actuator controller is not responding.
Yeah.
Okay.
I can usually reset it to have but it's not responding.
Yeah, it's not responding at all.
Is that because of that regulator?
I'm not sure if something happened with that turn on, but the sensors are coming in. It's just actually the controller not responding right now. I'm not sure what happened.
There we go.
Obviously, I took out the.
Yeah, I don't think it's your connection to the thing. I think the actuator controller is actually not responding.
Right.
So, should we have powered this off before we turned on the 12 volts to the the 24 volts to the whole system? Okay.
It's not going into any like data mainlines.
Okay.
Purely voltage.
Not everywhere.